As a surveyor, we sometimes face a dilemma while doing survey inside a river. A river has its own water flow and it also has a seawater ingress. So the tide measurement inside a river is more trickier than measuring tide out at sea. The problem gets more complicated if there are no standard port tide station nearby the survey area or inside the river. In India, we have lots of minor ports and harbors inside rivers and the creeks. And these waterways are used to ferry goods from one place to another. So maintaining a good navigable depth in these rivers are very crucial for Indian economy. Today, we'll discuss about few scenarios by which you can measure tide inside a river. But before we discuss about tide, we first have to understand how we measure tide and from where we measure tide. I have a video on my channel how and from where we measure the tide. I'll put the link on top and also in the description below. I strongly suggest that you go and watch that video first. In short, we measure tide from a vertical datum. And for that, we need a physical point somewhere safe on the shore. We call this physical point a benchmark. A vertical datum for that area will be certain distance below that benchmark. For example, a benchmark says a MSL or lat 4.5 meter. That means the vertical datum MSL or lat will be 4.5 meter below that benchmark or the physical point. This is very important for our survey, especially if you are doing survey inside a river. Suppose you have been asked to do a survey from estuary to about 10 km inside a river and the nearest standard port is 20 km away on the sea coast. There is no benchmark or tide station in your survey or inside the river. So what should you do? The first and foremost task of a surveyor is to establish vertical datum throughout the survey area so as to measure tide accurately. So we need to decide first what kind of vertical datum that we need to establish. Mean sea level, lowest astronomical tide and chart datum are some of the most commonly used vertical datums. Mean sea level is relatively easy to measure. Lowest astronomical tide will take about 28-29 days of continuous tide observation. And chart datum is normally very close to the LAT. But you cannot measure chart datum. It has to be decided and agreed upon. So in the first scenario, you decided to use the standard port tide datum and transfer it from there to your survey area. There are a couple of ways you can do that. And you have to follow a general rule as directed in the Admiralty Manual of Hydrographic Surveying, Volume 2. On the sea coast, you can transfer a datum up to a 16 km lateral distance from the standard port. But where the tidal range is very high and kind of erratic, like in the river, your tide station should be 1.6 km apart. So here a surveyor must use his experience and lay of the land to decide upon the distance by which he has to establish the benchmark inside the river. So how can you transfer the standard port datum to a new benchmark? One way of doing this is by observing simultaneous tide at both the established station and the new station. For this, you need to observe 4 low water and 3 high waters, and that also during the spring tide. Then using NP533 form or the transfer of sounding datum, you can calculate and establish a new datum line at the new benchmark. Remember, you are actually measuring where is your datum line in relation to the zero of the tide gauge. And you are supposed to level the zero of tide gauge in relation to your new benchmark. So you will get a datum line with reference to your new benchmark. Okay, now you have your datum. But there is also another way of transferring the sounding datum from one place to another place. For this, you need 2 DGNSS systems observing simultaneously at the established tide station and as well as the new benchmark. I suggest you observe Rhinex data at both the location for a minimum of 4 hours. Alternately, if you have a G2 system, you can also log the mean position at both the location for 4 hours. By doing simultaneous observation, we are trying to establish the height difference from ellipsoid to the established benchmark and take that same height and transfer it to the new benchmark. Here the datum level remains same, only that you are trying to find is where is your datum level in relation to your new benchmark. Let's now consider a scenario where there is no established tide station anywhere near the survey area. So how do we establish a brand new datum in our survey area? We have many different options that we can opt for, depending upon how much time do we have for the survey. It normally takes years and years of observation to establish a datum. But in commercial surveying, we don't have that liberty. 29 days of tide observation is the best solution to establish a tidal datum. Here you can calculate the lowest astronomical tide and mean sea level by doing harmonic analysis. Good thing is that you can also derive a lot of harmonic constituents that will help you in predicting the tide in that region. Quickest way of getting the MSL is by observing 39 hours of hourly data and apply a Dudson filter. But this kind of observation may have an anomaly of plus minus 25 centimeter. So if you have less time and willing to use the MSL as your primary datum for reducing the sounding in your area, then I suggest that you observe 48 hours of hourly tide and calculate multiple 39 hours Dudson filter data and then average all the results. This will give you somewhere about plus minus 10 centimeter accuracy. Another way we can get the tide in ocean is by satellite altimetry. Technical University of Denmark or DTU measures ocean surface by bouncing off the radar signal from the surface of the water at a specified fixed time interval. DTU now have a mean sea surface model for the entire world ocean. The data is 2 nautical mile by 2 nautical mile grid resolution, and the mean surface height is from the ellipsoid to the sea surface. And the mean height of the ocean surface is measured from WGS-84 ellipsoid. You can compare your observed tide data with the DTU model data and arrive at a more precise datum level at your location. But remember, DTU models are not so reliable when it comes to the river. This data is freely available in the internet with Creative Commons attribution, so you can use it. Okay, now that we have our main tidal station established at the river mouth near the survey area, we have to consider now how we can transfer this datum inside the river. When you are establishing your first tidal station and benchmark, you can observe the range of tide and flow of water inside a river and find suitable location where you can install a new benchmark and ways to install a tide gauge. If the range of the tide is not very high, then I suggest you can install a benchmark say every 3 to 4 kilometer lateral distance. Always remember, rivers may have excess water flow during the rainy season or during the water release from a nearby dam, if any. So once you have set up your benchmark inside the river, you can transfer the datum the same way we have discussed earlier. You can use Admiralty NP533 form to transfer the sounding datum, or you can use the DGNSS ellipsoidal height transfer method. One important thing you must remember that the lay of the land may get higher as you go upriver. So transferring datum by ellipsoidal height transfer method, where the datum level stays same, you may get a lot of drying heights as you go further upriver. But if you use transfer of sounding datum method, then the datum is transferred depending on how much water level rises and falls in that particular region. And this will give you a more realistic depth. No matter which method you use, you must log the data properly in your survey report. Now you may ask, which tide station shall I be using when I am in between the two tide stations? I suggest you use multiple tide station data and using the vessel's position as weighted mean to calculate the tide in your vessel's location. One fun fact before I conclude this video. You must have already seen that all the railway stations in India write the station height from mean sea level. Now, which mean sea level, or particularly which benchmark that they use to come to that mean sea level height? Any idea? During the British Raj, the benchmark at Karachi port was used to determine the mean sea level across the India. Now, after independence, that benchmark value has been shifted from Karachi port to Mumbai port, or more precisely at Apollo Bandar. So all the mean sea level value in India, either it is in railway station or the hill station, is with reference to the long forgotten benchmark in Mumbai port. Fascinating, isn't it? Thank you for being here and watching this video. I'll see you again soon.